Teshuva, and also the point of looking at Judith Clark's story was also to get you thinking about Teshuva, but Teshuva for a certain type of crime. So one point I just want to start out with, because I think it is something that a lot of you guys picked up on, was how realistic is it for a person to get back into the exact same situation in which they sinned, and then complete the ultimate Teshuva of the Rambam by not sinning? Okay, so that question would look different for questions like someone who is involved in a murder or in a major crime. But if you think about that question in terms of more daily issues, like let's say speaking Lashon Hara or davening without the proper intention or getting angry, or the types of, small scale sins that happen in the day to day, I think it's easier to imagine getting into the situation that the Rambam talks about, of being in that same situation again and kind of having the opportunity either to sin again or not to sin again. So I just want to kind of put that into your mind, kind of not just the major fate, but also the everyday fate that I think all of us encounter. Okay. So with that, let's look at Reb Zadok. I'll give a little bit of a background to Reb Zadok. The quotes that you see on this page are taken from his sefer, Sidkas HaTzadik, one of my most favorite sfarim in the world. The sefer that Reb Zadok wrote when he was 25 years old. Okay, so if that gives you any perspective, he wasn't so much older than you guys are today when he wrote the sefer. Reb Zadok was born in 1823 in a Misnadish household in Poland. He was known as an Eloy, a genius from a very young age. He got married at the age of 14 or 15, which in those days was fairly common. He lived in his wife's father's house and was supported by his wife and his in-laws. His in-laws owned a store and his wife worked there. During that period, for a few years, Reb Zadok sat and learned. The couple did not have any kids until, at a certain point, probably when Reb Zadok was 19 or 20, rumors reached him of his wife's miscarriage. There are various stories, I don't know how many of them are historically true, as to what the nature of the misconduct was. Was it that in the store she shook hands with a Russian general or a Russian officer? Whatever it was, her conduct in the business dealings in the store was not 100% to his liking. Reb Zadok also was a Kohen, so he, for that reason, was holding himself to a higher standard. Be that as it may, he decided to divorce his wife. His wife claimed that she was totally innocent and she had been supporting his Torah study for the past few years, and she just refused to accept the get. So, does anyone know what happens if a woman won't receive the get? What recourse does the man have? Okay, he can get what's called a heter mei rabbanan, okay, which means that he travels around and receives signatures of 100 of the greatest rabbis of the day. He can then be free to remarry, and he leaves the get to be held by the court in case his wife ever wants to receive it. So at that point, at the age of 20, Reb Zadok left his wife, set out traveling all over Europe to obtain the 100 signatures, and it was over the course of those travels that he encountered Reb Mordechai Yosef Liner of Ishbitz. The Ishbitzer Rebbe. Has anyone heard of him? Wow. Okay. So just three people. So he encountered the Ishbitzer, and basically, according to legend, overnight he really turned around his life and went from being a misnagid to being a chassid, which in those days was still a bit of a shift. This wasn't at the beginning of the Hasidic movement, so the rift between the misnagid and the chassidim wasn't as strong as it had been 100 years before, but it was still pretty radical for him to change his whole way of thinking overnight. And he became a chassid of the Ishbitzer, and he stayed learning with the Ishbitzer for the next close to 20 years, bless you, until the Ishbitzer's death. Okay? Now, a few other facts that I want to mention, and then we'll get started learning these texts, is that Rabbi Zadok ended up being married twice more before the end of his life. He was widowed and then remarried a third time. He never had any children. Okay? That fact is a significant one in understanding various aspects of Rabbi Zadok's thought, probably ones that we won't really get to discuss today, but it's a significant fact that though married three times, and this was before the days of birth control, he didn't have any children. Okay, that's kind of seen as it's a major theme in his writing, the fact that he was childless. It's just an interesting point to kind of keep in the back of our minds. Rabbi Zadok lived from 1823 to 1900. So just to place them for you guys, in 1901, the interpretation of dreams by Freud was first published. So Rabbi Zadok was really living in a time that was very close to the modern era, and his psychological insight is really quite modern, okay? So it's also something to keep in mind. You guys looked at the Hilchot Teshuva of the Rambam, right? The Rambam was writing about 700 years before Rabbi Zadok. So it's also something to keep in mind in terms of the difference in the way that they sound. Okay, so let's get started. We're going to look at really just a few passages from Rabbi Zadok, which I think are kind of can be used together to build a very different picture of what chet and tshuva are, and then hopefully that will give you guys something to think about in terms of the tshuva of the Rambam, the tshuva of Rabbi Zadok. Hopefully by the time next Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur roll around, you guys will then have two different models to choose from. Okay, does anyone want to read? I don't know how you guys usually work. Do people usually read? I'm happy if someone wants to volunteer to read so you guys can not just hear my voice the whole time. Yeah. And you could tell me your name before you start.
Okay.
So why don't you start from Reish Nun Chet, okay?
Eger Adam to Atashak Shubalev, Shubo Gui Jonosh Al Kolakin, Mekhu Atikra Yetzer Tov Yetzera.
Okay, so let's stop there. Okay? Rabbi Zadok starts off by saying that the essence of a person is the desire of his heart. By the way, all the translations are mine. Rabbi Zadok, as well as many Hasidic texts, have not yet been translated into English. Right, so the essence of man is the desire of the heart, okay? And he says that's a way in which the human being is better than the angels. And that quality of desire is called yetzer, okay? And that quality of yetzer can be expressed either as yetzer tov or as yetzer ra, okay? So now this is something that's interesting to think about, and I don't know how you guys have thought about it until now, the relationship between good and evil, or the relationship between the yetzer tov and the yetzer hara. Rabbi Zadok at this point is saying that really there's just one quality which is called yetzer, and it has two aspects to it. Okay, and he's going to go on to show that it's really kind of two sides of the same coin. Okay,
keep going.
Right. Okay. So when that quality of yetzer, okay, is expressed for the good, then that's good. Okay, and if not, then the opposite. Okay, then it's going to be negative.
The other is that kol gadol mechaber yetzer gadol mipayminel ki gadol echad mechaber huda rak vegodel chashav shabal lato dahinu kach meyetzer ki yetzer tov meyetzer ra echad.
Okay. Then Rabbi Zadok quotes a Gemara in Sukkah, Kol ha-gadol mechaveru yitro gadol himenu. Has anyone learned this Gemara before? Yeah? Do you remember what it's about?
No, I just remember the quote itself.
Okay. Got it. So the quote is saying that anyone who is greater than their friend, so too their yetzer, okay, this quality of desire is correspondingly greater, okay? The story that the Gemara tells there, it's an interesting story, it's a story of Abaye, who saw a man and woman, like an unmarried man and woman, walking together, as if like kind of walking to work together. And Abaye said, I'm going to go and follow them to make sure that they don't sin. Okay, because it was obvious to Abaye, the Amora, that if a man and woman who aren't married to each other are going on a joint voyage, they're going to come to sin. So Abaye follows them the whole way. And at the end, right at the end of the road, they part and they say, basically, have a great day. And Abaye is really distraught, okay, because he says, oh my gosh, had it been me, I definitely would have sinned. And here, these two regular people are able to walk together to work and everything is okay. So then it says that Abaye kind of leans against the doorpost in great sadness until someone, who legend says is Eliyahu HaNavi, came to comfort him and said, Kol ha-gadol mechavero yitro gadol mimenu, that the greater the person, the greater this quality of yetzer. In other words, the greater this quality of desire, which could be expressed either for the good or for the bad. Okay, so what Rabbi Zadok says is, in invoking this Gemara, he's making the point that the greater the person, okay, obviously the greater their desire for good, but also the greater potential their desire for evil, okay? And he says it very clearly at the end when he says, ki yetzer tov, ki yetzer ra, echa. Right? The yetzer tov and the yetzer hara are really the same thing. Zelu matzeh shnei chalalei halev. They're totally parallel to each other in the two chambers of our hearts. Okay? Now, I think this is an important point in terms of understanding Reb Zadok about sin and repentance. It's very important to understand that he's grounded in this conception of what the yetzer is. Okay? Because if we see good and bad as really two sides of the same coin, which I think that a lot of us don't, but maybe I'll stop and ask, does Reb Zadok's idea sound different to you, or is it how you always kind of imagine things? That's how you imagine things. Okay. Is there anyone for whom hearing that the good and the evil are two sides of the same coin is something new or something they wouldn't have imagined? Anyone here who would have thought that good is kind of good and evil is something that's like unrelated to it? Yeah? Okay, I think that's really the, the traditional approach, which I assume that most of us would think. Right? In other words, most of us wouldn't expect our rabbi or our religious leader to fall into a serious sin, right? We would be surprised at that. We would say, no, our leadership has to kind of only have their yetzer tov working, but not the yetzer hara, because ra and evil is something kind of different. Once we say that good and evil are two sides of the same coin, and once we say that kol ha-gadol mechavero yitzro gadol mimenu, that really opens up, it opens up a kind of dangerous category, which is to say that the people who are the rabbanim or the leadership or the people that we look to as role models for the good also have tremendous potential to have converted that same good to the bad. Okay? So this is kind of the first point that Sadhguru was making, is the kind of total kind of even-handedness of the good and the bad, that they're two sides of the same coin. Yeah.
Is it that when people become better, they have more potential to do bad? Or is it that they have more power to do bad? Maybe if you're a leader, so then you maybe are able to manipulate people. You have more people available to you to do bad things to do.
Right. So the thing is, you could look at it in like a kind of pragmatic sense like that, but I think what Rabbi Zadok is saying is he's not looking at the kind of the audience, he's looking at the person themselves. He's saying that same quality which drives a person to be able to do good could just as easily drive them to do bad. Kind of not looking at who's going to be affected, but just at the person themselves. Okay, it's something that Rabbi Zadok talks about, that like the very moment that a person is on the path to do something bad is a moment of tremendous potential because of how much of this quality of desire is in that moment that they could then flip it around and use it for the good. Okay, so he really sees the good and the evil as two manifestations of ratzon, or of yetzer, whatever cheshet, whatever word you want to use, okay? And basically, things can really go either way, okay? Which is, I think, right? It's something where I expect, right, where I expect more people
to be better.
You
don't think that, like, in a second you're going to do bad things. You've worked on yourself. You've had a process to become good, or you've had a process to become bad. You don't think you're going to flip and do the opposite.
Right. So there is something very interesting about that in the Torah that I love, Rabbi Zadok, where he talks about that potential in the moment when a person is on the pathway to do a sin. He says, Gvaldik, there is the most potential in that moment to turn it around and do something positive. Because it's that same energy that can move one in either direction. Let me get you first and then, yeah.
That, like, it's often hard becoming better is overcoming harder and harder things and stuff. That it is, but sometimes you find the harder things that have to go along path rather than towards the bottom and it gets easier. It doesn't get easier, it gets harder. So if you think about it that way, like when you think about practicing and you're self-working yourself, that is the way it works. Like things do get harder as it goes on.
Okay.
So it makes sense. Like,
okay.
I don't think he's talking about a situation where someone has worked with himself to become a better person. I think he's talking about the inherent quality of the person, our given potential that we have.
Right.
And if someone has more given potential, they have equal potential for good and bad. If you work on yourself, then you can optimize the potential for good and bad. It's not if you get better, you get more potential for bad. It's you how you deal with your inherent quality.
Right. I think that's a good point that you're making. Is that a person, what Rav Zadok is talking about is a person is born with those inherent qualities. But what it also means is something surprising, which is that for Abaye, and I'm assuming you guys have all heard of Abaye, right?
Yeah.
Okay? Right? One of the greatest Amoraim, okay? For Abaye, because of that quality in terms of how he was born with his great potential, it also meant that down the road when he was Abaye, still would be fighting on the other side that same potential for evil that the simple farmer who kind of walked to work with this woman wasn't grappling. So I think that that's also something that's interesting for us at least to think about it, and I think it's something that we don't usually assume, right? In other words, we don't usually assume that the greater the person, the greater their potential desire for evil, right? We don't usually assume that. Yeah, there's one more comment? Okay. Yeah.
It just makes also the distinction between a good person and a bad person very fuzzy. So like how do you punish or hold people accountable for certain things? Because it's just interesting, like there's no one or the other. They're kind of they're both, and it's just the decisions that we chose very fuzzy, unclear and wrong.
It's true what you're saying, that it's unclear kind of how things will turn out. But for a tzaddok, right, there's action. The actions that you do, you're going to be held accountable. But the point is that it's not like you had to have done those actions.
But you're saying,
you have that.
Right, but you know, like, there's this great, rabbi, and but inside his head, he's sitting there, and he has a much stronger inclination to do wrong things. And you would think, you know, you're a pure person, you're a good person, you're going to be held accountable for that goodness. There's nothing bad going on in your head. You'd be even more pure and even less inclined to do that thing, but
right.
It's the opposite.
Right. So that's why I'm saying, I'm glad that you brought out that comment, that this Gemara, and Rav Tzadok's reading a bit of Kol HaGadol Mechaber Yisro Gadol Himenu, is in some ways really counterintuitive to us, right? It's not what we would assume kind of was going on behind kind of the face of Abaye, this giant Torah scholar. That's true. Okay? Let's keep moving because it's going to get stranger. Okay? So step one, okay, that we've seen from this first Torah is really the double-sided nature of the Yetzer. Okay? And the way that good and bad are two sides of the same coin. Okay? Let's move on to the next source. Anyone else want to read? Anyone? Okay, I'll read the next source and then I'll offer you guys a chance again. Okay, so this is Torah Yud Aleph. The next two Torahs that we're going to see, Aleph and Yud Gimel, are taken from the beginning of Tikvah at Zadok, the way that it's organized, the beginning of Zadok has Torahs on the beginning of Masechet Brachot, okay? So these comments are kind of tied to things that are going on in the beginning of the Gemara Brachot. Right, you got the beginning of the Gemara Brachot talks about the time for Kriyat Shema, so it deals with issues of time, of day and night. Okay, Rabbi Zadok is going to deal with those issues of time, but in a different way. So he says as follows: Yal finan mibriyaso shel olam, de b'chol davar halayla kodem liyom, kedeita reish brachos. And so we learn from the creation of the world that in everything the night precedes the day. Okay, we see this in the beginning of Brachot. Does anyone remember from Briat HaOlam, or can anyone think back in Briat HaOlam, how do we know that the night precedes the day?
By Yair,
okay? First is the night, and then is the day, okay? Now, Tzadok, though, isn't going to read that as just night and day, right, the time, it's night and day. He's going to read that as saying something different about the quality of the time. So what he says is as follows: Ki b'chol davar haheder kodem lahalaya. That in everything, absence precedes presence. Okay? And if you think about this in terms of the religious life of the individual, what does it mean that absence precedes presence? Okay, it also means that chet precedes tshuva. Okay? V'ki yeshiv b'choshech eida ki achar kach Hashem orli. Okay? And only when I sit in darkness will I know that afterwards God is my light. Ki kol chaye ha'adam kach murkavim yasam. Choshech v'or yom v'layla kach chozer chalim. Okay, so he says that all of a person's life are composed of time in that way. Okay? In that there's first darkness, then light. Okay? Day and night, and it can then repeat itself. Okay, so what Tzadok is saying here, okay, is that it's only when you sit in the darkness that you know that God is your light. He's basically saying that the state of chet or of sin comes before the state of tshuva. Okay, which in some ways, okay, might be obvious to us, right? What is there anything to do tshuva about if there wasn't a sin? Right? But in other ways, I think what Rabbi Zadok is doing here is again something different. Because Rabbi Zadok is putting chet and tshuva into nature. And he's saying that it's part of the cycle of nature, that just as night precedes day, so too sin has to precede tshuva. Okay, which means that he's saying that on a certain level, there's an inevitability to sin. Okay, that sin, that chet, is embedded into nature. And just like we have to first get through the night before we can get through to the day, so too, in our own spiritual life, we first have to experience distance from God before we can experience connection to God. Okay, now I'll read the next Torah where he kind of makes this point again, and then I want to hear what you think of it. So Torah Yud Gimel, he goes on and he says, Hazman murkav miyom halayla, right? Time is composed of day and night. V'kein chaye adam or v'choshech. And so too, a person's life has both light and darkness. Ole v'yoreg. We go up, and then we go down. Ki adua ma'amar ha'bal shem al pasuk sheva yikol tzadik v'kam. Okay, as is known what the Baal Shem Tov said about the Pasuk, that a tzaddik, a righteous person, falls seven times and then picks themselves up. Okay? So Tzadok is saying here, and I think that this is something that's also not that common, and I think it's something that in the framework of the Rambam, right, kind of wouldn't exist. But Tzadok is basically saying that sin is embedded in nature. Okay, and that the process of first falling into sin and then standing up and doing tshuva is in itself a part of nature. He quotes the pasuk that says Sheva Yichol Tzadik Yikam, which I think is a remarkable pasuk. It says that the tzadik, the righteous person, first falls seven times. Okay, sin seven times before they pick themselves up, okay, into tshuva. Okay? So again, here what Rabbi Zadok is doing is, I think, something very different than the Rambam in terms of normalizing sin. To say sin is something that happens, that's a part of nature, that's a part of the cycle of personal growth and development. Now, how does that sound? Yeah. Repentance and and what's required, and you even have to go into galut, exile yourself, and change your name, and do all these very radical things in terms of repentance. So for me, I read the Rambam, I said, what type of a sin is the Rambam talking about? And if he's talking about murder, then I understand it, because it's such a, the demand of tshuva is such a radical break from everything that you were before that we kind of have to, I think, imagine the Rambam talking about sin as this one-time thing that happens, and then it defines the rest of your life. But I think that for most people, and you could just nod if you're relating to this at all, that sin is not this one-time radical thing, but it's something that is embedded in the day-to-day of our lives. Right?
Not murder.
Right, not murder, obviously. I'm not talking about murder. What I'm talking about is, are some of those smaller things, issues of character traits that we're dealing with in terms of anger, in terms of jealousy, in terms of the way that we speak, the way that we speak about other people, the way that we use our words, our focus during davening, our focus during learning, certain aspects of being Adolah Chavero. I think that all of those are things where the sin isn't a one-time thing that we do and then end up in prison and kind of forced to do a process of tshuva. The sin is something that happens. It's happening every day. So I think that for that type of thing, the tshuva of the Rambam kind of seems in some way impossible. Right? How do you ever do tshuva, right, for all of those little things that we're doing wrong at every, you know, every hour of the day? Okay? I think that for Reb Tzadok, and maybe we could say that the Rambam and Reb Tzadok were talking about different types of sins, and therefore, right, we could use the Rambam, Chas v'Shalom, if anyone, you know, chances cross a murder. I don't wish it upon any of us, but you know, saying something very extreme. Whereas for the day-to-day, kind of the little things that happen on a daily basis, for that I think Reb Tzadok is more relevant. Okay? One point that I want to kind of stress before, go for it.
I have a test now.
No, that's fine. Everyone who needs to should feel comfortable to get up and take the test. Because I don't want to leave you at this juncture of hearing about the inevitability of sin without then hearing about what tshuva is. So please try to find it out for someone who needs to stay for the rest. But basically where we're left now, okay, in Reb Tzadok's thought, is that we've seen the double-sided nature, okay, of Yitzhak. Okay, we've seen...
Following students, please come to college guidance. Jared Esmond, Aaron Abramowitz, Randy Atias, Natalie Bensadi, to the college guidance office.
Okay. We've seen that Reb Tzadok sees that sin is embedded in nature, okay, and is sometimes inevitable.
Jonas Levin to the main office. Jonas Levin to the main office.
Okay. We've seen, okay, the way that sin is sometimes inevitable and the way that sin is embedded in nature. Okay? So if we were to just stop here, okay, and say sin is embedded in nature, so know that if you're struggling with sin, that that's something that's natural and normal to be struggling with, and know that that process of sin and religious growth is a process that everyone goes through, that would be kind of one step in Reb Tzadok's thought, okay? But Reb Tzadok really goes beyond that, okay? And he goes beyond that to talk about not just sin in general as being something that's kind of inevitable in a person's religious life, but he goes on to talk about the specifics of whatever sin each individual is struggling with. Okay? Excuse me. So we're going to move on now to read Torah Mem Tet. And if there's anyone who wants to read it, it would be fabulous.
I'll read it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Kol Ha'ad Yadasha Bama Chia Tru to Phobia Karamu Palaimo Fano Tam Divarim Leo Terali Yoga Kayam and that came out loud.
Okay, so let's just stop there for a second. Okay, so everyone should know that in the very area where their yetzer, right, where this quality of desire incites them the most, okay? In that same area, that person is a receptacle for these things to be good and pure, okay? Reb Tzadok is going to go on. We'll understand better what he's saying in a second. So, keep going. Okay, so and with regard to things, and I think this is not an accident, or to other writers, right? Things that a person has sinned with, okay? In other words, a sin that has a person has repeated a lot, okay? They should know that in that area specifically, they can be pure and good. Okay? So, just to clarify, okay, or what Reb Tzadok is saying here. Reb Tzadok is saying that every person, okay, in the world is struggling with something different. Okay? And he's going to go on to talk about the fact that really for no two people is this going to be exactly the same thing. Okay? What Reb Tzadok says is that you should know that in your life, very thing that you struggle with the most, that is the area that you were born to fix. Okay, so suddenly, sin is not just an opportunity in terms of what Reb Tzadok has spoken about until this point, that there are cycles of darkness and light, and that you have to pass through the darkness before you can get to the light, right? That you just have to pass through sin before you can get to repentance. So we have to pass through it. What Reb Tzadok is saying here is that it's not sin in general, but it's actually the very specifics of the sin that you are struggling with in your life that teaches you that that is the area in which you were put in this world to effect some sort of tikkun or fixing for. Okay? Let's keep reading it to understand it better, but I think that this is an amazing idea, okay? Because what Reb Tzadok is doing is, he's not only normalizing process of sin, kind of broadly, but what he's doing is he's saying the very specifics, the details of whatever it is that you are struggling with are meaningful in and of themselves, because they teach you a lesson. They teach you this is the area that you were born to fix. So it's almost like instead of sin, okay, and this is where I think, I want you guys to think back to the Rambam, right? Instead of sin being something that's negative and terrible, and we want to distance ourselves from it entirely by changing our name afterwards, right, et cetera, et cetera, suddenly sin becomes an opportunity, okay? And what it becomes here is it's God kind of giving you the message or giving you this tap on the shoulder saying, this is the area that you need to work on and that you have something, some sort of tikkun to do. Yeah.
Wouldn't that only work if a person, like, sinned in one general